Actually, yeah, you know. But you're constantly looking at, is this the right thing to do, as opposed to, you know, work maximize profits so that we can maintain a fiduciary responsibility to investors. And it's a platform of open source, and that's a platform that is going to be given away to everybody around the world who can use it. But we want to get rich, so we're going to give it away. It's a protocol learning. It's a platform in the code, I also know, where we go through special Berkeley applications under the name Berkeley. So the X brand has become a very popular brand where adults have X, UTS and X, and so on, offer social and various platforms. LX also works really hard in the search engine. We drive a huge amount of data on the platform. And even as a nonprofit, LX shares all of the data with our university partners. There are all university partners who access to all of the data to do the research and ask students for learning, thereby improving the quality of learning outcomes as well. Our vision is really twofold, is to improve access to education around the world, but to also reinvent campus education, to really rethink what campus education should look like by applying technology to education. So, what do you think we're doing in this category? In a typical class, let's say at MIT, about 18,000 students applied last year, and MIT admitted 1,800 students. In the first search that I saw for them about a year ago, we had 155,000 students from 163 countries take the course. So these students are from all over the world. And just imagine, this is a hard course, a circuit and webinars course. The video of our courses are compared with the video of the campus course. We don't have to compromise some of it. And the notice that after 155,000 students, over 7,200 students completed the course and passed the course. And in the past, they got a certificate from MIPS saying that they passed the course. So the interesting thing is that really is that the platform and organization of that is about it. There is that the resources you use for the course is about the same as a 150-person on-campus class. So the scale can be very, very efficient. But clearly, there's a huge scaling advantage here. At the same time, when you face an example where they don't have a dramatic quality advantage as well, but let me give you an example. So one of the things that we did was, so they're looking at some courses worldwide, and it's also committed to campus education, to examine them. So what we did was, we also have a model called SPOT. We don't need this, not to make a long run for it. The second model is a model called SPOT, small pilot model. So you can do a sort of small course, some of the not so small course, on the campus, one of the students register on the campus. So as an example, we hosted a small course for San Jose State University, pilot, in Silicon Valley, in California, in fall, starting in August 2012. Okay, here, the students would rip the costume, they would watch the videos and talk about exercises, and virtual laboratory with their bodies, and they would come to class, and in the class, the professor would not lecture. The professor would interact with the students, for 15 minutes on the same test. And then the students would break up into groups of three and discuss the problems and the problem solving. The results were staggering. The results were absolutely staggering. But originally, in this course, it's a hard course, initially, San Jose State had about 40% of the students trying to retake this course. 40%. So the LX course, the retake rate, but if we put in the results, the retake rate dropped to 9%. Extraordinary! And this is a problem. From 31% to 9%. And the new story is that not only can we reduce the cost of education, increase access for everybody, but I think that it's worth exciting to all of us that we can improve the quality of education. It can improve learning outcomes for our students, all of our campuses, when we offer a course in a blended manner. and a vision model with an online course, but you augment it with an instructor or a PA that can work with the students. And this is particularly important for students that try to achieve the gap and are struggling to begin. So, to look at the real society, to look at the online PA youth course, 7,200 out of 155,000, 5% pass the course. Really, when it drops, 91% of the students pass the course. Look at these two bookings. So, even the 5%, arguably, they're about the MOOC warrior. They're just looking at the magnitude of the course. And you define active students as those that take from at least one level. So, of the 155,000 students, 26,000 kids are a real problem. And so those are active learners. Real world, the percentage of active learners, about 25% of the students, 7,200, 25% of the active learners are the faculty. But still, 25% of 90% is a very important. And so the blended model can be achieved successfully at a higher percentage of the return. And so all of that, in addition to offering the MOOCs for students worldwide, and we have over 2,000 students from Minnesota taking my courses, and this is exactly the number. But we also have working with campuses. We're working with community colleges, and Mass Baker University College, and Duncan Aiken University in Massachusetts. We have great foundations from the study to see whether we can offer these courses in community colleges in a blended manner, much like we did in San Diego State. And thereby, improves learning outcomes of community colleges as well. We're also seeing a blended classroom pop up in other places around the world. So if you think about this way, so that we're in this run on far, far away, a restructure in a high school, same thing happened in high school. A restructure in high school took us to one of the best courses and started to the blended model for 20 students in the high school class. So the students are doing their communities in their buildings and on the homes and come to class and they problem solving and do labs as you can see in the picture. So any blessing that's available to us? And the labs far, far away.
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin. Far, far away. Wisconsin.
China.
China. Nope. Indonesia? Nope. Mongolia. In Mongolia, absolutely. 10 points there in the boxing. But what happened in Mongolia? Since the time that we have a living success, and that's part of it, with this process, we discovered a 15-year-old called Batista. Batista is a 15-year-old taking a junior level of IT class, a hard course, and he got a perfect 100 in the first. 15-year-old, because he's a genius. Since then, because we are Yoruba, we now apply to MIT, and virtually. I pretend to school what we were replacing, and I recommend a letter of recommendation myself. And based on what we learned in the course, even better, even better, based on what we learned in the course, we're in Mongolia, we built a little business that enabled cars that came out of the garage to be warned that we were pedestrians in the back crossing the street. And he did me the wrong one, the car was coming down. And he walked to the lights of the car and warned the pedestrians that the car was coming down. So not only took this story from that school, he learned from it, he got a perfect 100, and then he invented a bigger than digital of an ordinary system for pedestrians based on the world. That's the kind of impact we need to have on the island around the world, and on that country. So with that, I'd like to spend some time on technology. What do we look at? What is an online learning experience system? And this is the online learning experience that we have at LX. We're way beyond what has been the tool of online learning over the past 10, 20 years. All of them have been happening for 20, 20 years, and I've also got a pretty bad one. But we've got a long, for a long way. We have improved campus education, we're very on our campuses. At this second, MIT has about 1,600 students a year, and so a total of 6,400 undergraduates. of which the people who have the largest, one fourth of them, 50 million of the largest, in one way, shape, or form, are using blended online learning using apps on the United Campus. 25% of the students. And this is happening in Berkeley and a number of other universities as well as happening in Tampa. So it's not just new to be a lot of new to access, but they're changing campuses and improving campuses at the same time. So, let me describe the course very briefly. This is the Berkeley Artificial Intelligence course. And notice that on the top you see a bunch of tabs for the discussion forum, you see a video, and the wiki where people can collaborate. All of this course for all the students to engage in the course. So you see the course work right here. And also the concept of learning sequences. And again, this presentation is learning sequences. So learning sequences equal to lecture. Okay, my lecture is on the 6th and gospel. That can be a mod, but not a policy. So I have a lot of things. So the lecture will be for now. So here what we do is we invent a learning sequence. So these take a sequence of video clips, 5 to 10 minutes long, interweave them with interactive exercises. So video clips interweave with interactive exercises with a learning sequence. So the students are much more engaged. The account's given the right-hand side, so we make them work more accessible, and also the students to be watching it at their own speed. Some students shut the audio and just read the text. They can speed up the video, they can pause it. So, this is a learning kit homepage, wherever you are, at your own time, and you're finding most of the downloads happening if you move right into the page. So, here's a learning at your own time. So, this concept of learning sequences really leverages some of the skills that have been done in learning over 30, 40 years ago, and something that happened then. So this is not the true stuff, this is reading by the fish. So the study by Clark and Lockhart, one of my favorite papers, that shows that learning and attention is related to the depth of mental processing. This says that to engage the student when they're teaching, it's the ultimate topicization of education. If you ask questions and engage the student, they will get much more out of it than really the unit down to the fact of it. And it's all been started before the process. Why am I asking you a question? Okay, and how do you think about where you're going in learning? And my hope is that that little answer. You know, if you're doing some thinking about, well, you've already really learned that much in learning compared to what you've done in transportation or healthcare and so on and so forth. And these learning sequences really promote this concept of active learning. So there's real research behind this in a way that you can improve learning. So, there are also a number of ways in which you can replace lectures. One, you can have tablet capture in video snippets. You can do your capture with a professor talking. You can do different kinds of stories. There are a number of ways in which you can do these videos. And here's an example of what I call a hands-on video. So, all of them are inspired by Starfleet. In my case, I think, just a little bit of credit. This is, I don't have a credit for Starfleet. He was my student. I'm IT. And it's been great, he's been very interested in me. And so here's a video, it's a 5-10 video. And we start your library, and so people have these kind of groupings, so people can pull out things, they can run things at their own speed, and so on and so forth. And in fact, myself has been tuned into student learning. So this is a paper on NeuroLab. So NeuroLab shows that in 2003, so the students were able to face themselves, the learning outcomes would be better. So all of you have been in the lecture hall. I've been in the lecture hall. And if you are like me, what used to happen to me was in my class, in the lecture hall, I would give it around the 5 or 7 minute mark. I would lose the professor. You know, I would not have too many people around me. And the professor would be going through the class, I would lose the professor on the 6th or 7th minute, and then after that, in the remaining 45 minutes or 50 minutes, I was scrambling to try to copy notes, so I had no idea what the professor was talking about. If only I could have called the professor and removed my email, it would have helped me. I said, well, the study was showing that students can learn at their own pace. It was much better for me if the professor was in the same place. So I was much more humble than the class. who does like to be one seat under the bus. But really, nobody had the XP. We all really knew that you could only do this. I could follow it and move on. In fact, after we were 11, we took a photo of the students. And we called them Vendor Class at MIT. And during the students told me that they watched the videos in 1.5 times the speed. So different people watch it at different speeds. So that we did a lot of things with the professors to our faculty. So we built a TV called the studio, where we could see it in a large volume of places. The professors can also quickly for easy. Also, in a venue place on campus, professors can use that to change the base from things like that. We also built online course called LX101. LX101 is an online course, but it will teach an online course. Now, interestingly, we have I got my students to start home to continue the video in my course. It was a SoundCloud video on how to create a SoundCloud video. So we're really taking the instruction to the online learning services. In addition to the video, we have the interactive exercises where students can enter answers in the computer and do interview classes. So looking at that, when we learned which set of the automatically created exercises, we were critical to give students instant feedback. The first thing they did was to answer the instant feedback. We were going to do that for what we can do to create it, and we thought to get the video to work, we could actually see this. And so we were able to get the video to work and can function in the next button, we see the video read, and we see how students are going to get the video. So that's what we're going to do. So here we go, students are protecting, enter it into the closing, and we get rid of the instant. You can see the check mark in there, they can check it into instantly. And the computer is great. The beauty of instant grading is that students get instant feedback. So all of us are homework submitted, but we got the feedback to each grade. And it's not interesting anymore. Here with instant feedback, you can try multiple times to get it done. So this is an element of verification of learning, where you can keep trying to be good at that. And students are saying that they're working much harder, they're not really good at it because they can keep trying and get things right. And in fact, when students get things right, they get a green check mark indicating something wrong. And a green check mark can become sort of a health symbol of things. The students are saying that in the discussion forums that they're going to go and dream of the green check mark. In fact, when the students have picked up two other courses in the spring semester in 2012, and then took a small course in Berkeley online, yes. Here is what we have to say on the discussion forum with respect to the green tick mark. You need a green tick mark, and the veterans right. Here is what the students have to say about the green tick mark. Go down, how about this one? So it's amazing how the instant feedback and the simple thing that the green tick mark has become a part of it. Our students are really engaged when you give them immediate feedback. They keep trying to learn about it, but they're learning much better. And, not surprisingly, they're students. We study those things that rapid feedback has a significant positive effect on student performance compared to the long term instant feedback. So these are the proof points of changing that. The LX platform, the MOOC that we created, the Blender platform that LX is creating, the sophisticated technology, is improving learning outcomes. This is not the online learning of a decade ago, but really going back. Here, we are clearly improving learning outcomes. So, this platform is another big part of online learning, where students are talking to each other and helping each other and doing the social component of the course. Now, the whole social component is a big deal. So I have a 50-year-old daughter, and it's in the ocean. And in the same thing that we did a teenager, something strange happened. Suddenly we began to speak this new language called English. Because English has two sounds in it, that's it. Two sounds, in vigor. A grunt and silence. And if it's not talking, then it's only grunts and silence. And I really have to communicate with my teenager son. Until one day he said, if I text him, I got an instant response. It was an opinion. So our military generation was really confident. They were dealing with online stuff, with skills. the brain of the world. And so, rather than finding an attraction, OS embraces it. OS is unique in that OS is the first MOOC platform to administer the course to introduce online discussion forums as part of that. It is the very first MOOC course that launched in February of last year to have the discussion forum as integrated to the platform. So here students can post questions, get answers, and it's a big deal. This is how we're able to handle hundreds of thousands of students taking the course. So imagine how much you answer questions. The two reasons why we need this lesson program here. First of all, many students have the same question. So once you see ask the question, you can upload it. Students who come in and write this up on Facebook. So how many of you have Facebook accounts? How many of you have a like button? So for you that are not active, if you have a little button on the right hand side, the plus button, that's locked. So you can click on that to ask the question. And so if multiple students have the same question, you would like the question. And so everybody doesn't have the same question in the world. The second thing is that students are helping each other by answering questions from each other. They're also teaching and learning by learning by teaching. And if you're able to get the skills and the students, you're able to practice, but in fact, you're answering all the questions, the students are answering the first questions. It's absolutely spectacular. So when you began this a year and a half ago, you could ask me, where's the one thing you've learned? But you did not know before. I feel like I learned a bunch of things that I know I knew. But this was one, which is when you began the course, I mean, these people are too nice. You have 155,000 students going to take the course. And I said, how are we going to answer questions? You have no idea. You don't have to click, click, and you can use all the stuff you're going to do in the course. Okay? You have no idea how you're going to do this. But this was what saved us. The discussion forum, the students were answering each other's questions, was here. Because of this, we could teach 100,000 students course, but the same number of instructors, the PAs, are going to be 150,000 campus course, and help each other, and they also learn about each other. So, this is an example of how we embrace modern culture, and embrace open networking for working with us. One of the remarkable things that has is a virtual library. So the sort of people say that oh, you can't do your virtual, you can't do your live experience in an online course. You can't do that. Well, the new question is, never. The LXR platform is unique in its respect as online laboratories. So I'll show you an example of a virtual lab where students are given a brand to the paper. In most books and in most courses, we have an online course and exercise where you can analyze and get an answer. What do you do analysis? But how do you teach someone constructivism? How do you teach someone design and creativity? You need online math to do it. You get to get a match to the paper and have to create something, to build something. That teaches creativity and design. So the online lab, maybe this is the video you're looking at, you can run the video and see someone doing the lab for your class. But for now, I'm going to be able to do it to the paper. And you can see this world has done something. And the model like these, you can really put components and build constructive self designs, and they will submit the design for the next constructive design for the next. So this is very unique to a platform that we have in the laboratory. So here you have another element of gamification to the platform, and students can really have fun designing them. We also bring music into our libraries. So here at home, the video is working, you can run this video, and if you have another kind of laboratory, where you bring music into it. Students can bring different kinds of music, like reggae, or rock, or other kind of music, and apply music in the laboratory, and really hear about these things. So we do all of this in the computer, everything is done by computer. Number one, all of these students are very well certified. So here is a certificate from MIT for a student pass the course. And we need to do it if you pass the course. It's all the same for the completion of that degree. And most written certificates have ever been a certificate of master. And students are telling you that using the certificate to further their career. The last thing you told them that they got a job at a software company in New York. and the credit to Eric Swiss for getting that job. The other students who have learned from high school, from the colleges, and use this credential from Eric before they get forward. So there's been a number of people making use of these things. So right now, the certificates are also free. So Eric Swiss has a regular use of the professor and a unique identifier and maintains a confidential certificate. The sustainability story for me as well, and to discuss and enjoy the provision of possibly enabling youth for only the child of small food. And the thinking would be that child in the area of $3,200 for the same cost as a certificate or an approach that you're pursuing for a few days after the course. You pay that much more taxes. And by the way, you also have two factors for that cost, a number of factors managers. Or looking at this, particularly because we are one child, and give us free textbooks online for our kids. When students can give free and value your book in the number, and what we've shown is that the book in this is a good deal, what we've shown them is that the students have shown up for about 500% of the world while giving us free books on top. So the students taking the online course, there's a benefit of that as well. We have students from all over the world taking these courses. About 25% of our students are from the United States. The next contingent comes from India, UK. And these are the first year members, the 2 month old members from the UK and Colombia. So the students from all over 192 countries taking these courses. So the reason for closing is that students are coming from India. As I mentioned in the past, the students from Pakistan, to send this to a multi-modern school of technology. So as professors and as teachers and instructors and engineers in the U.S., the market of research really has been that we are interested. Thank you, and I would love to ask you your questions from the audience. Yes.
Some of the issues that the committee is dealing with are large or high tuition costs and substantial amount of debt. It seems as though the pedagogy in the classroom is flipping. But in schools are taking on that flipping of the pedagogy in the classroom, the blended classroom. But the costs continue to rise. You talk about efficiencies through this platform. When will students start to realize
We can use these courses after the modern day equivalent of a test.
One gateway that folks have mentioned using MOOCs is for remediation. Because the process for those who aren't up to speed in regards to college entry, this seems like a good platform for them to do it at their own pace, on their own time, to get the mastery that they need for college. That's just credit with college entry.
Absolutely. say, earlier in high school, it's like a free calculus instead, and the students are dropping out too. So we very, very have to address some of these drop-off rates. But often, the legal course is early. And that's happening to be perfect to me. I mean, we're very enthusiastic about doing that. By the time out, let's start from new local sources. And in addition, if we make the top-down open source, people can do that themselves better. And then to into the and we're closing now into the 7th week. And so the results of that have been extremely encouraging. And if the results continue to be as encouraging, we will be definitely looking at expanding the multiple aspects of colleges and universities around the country, including from the interior.
Any barriers right now? Barriers to entry,
barriers
that...
Well, I think the value of this theme, and this relates to the conversation we're going to do, is that the number of regulations and laws, obviously, we've seen in the time of the years, where regulations are clearly assuming a certain kind of technology. And as we advance technology, the certain regulations will not fit. And you can look at technology, so I'll give an example, you said an example, where the regulations are in place, and it's a benefit to everybody. So, we're an impediment to students and these other people. And for the new legislation, we make it more immediate to these other students, makes a lot of sense. And, I wish you the rest of luck in doing that. I also want to think a little further about the fact that new students help us learn. To me, the for-profit study, I have to tell you, they are actually in profit. But there's a company called Baby Fatigue. They only stay around as if you get bonus. They are deep profit when you keep giving you money. And so you have to have one of them to sustain yourself. And you don't need a whole lot to be able to profit. But you still need to sustain yourself. And you have a number of good sustaining numbers. One is the cost of certificates. And then there's one of the 50-year numbers. So that can be one of them. Another approach is to I talk about the small private online courses in community colleges that are not in universities. We call them small private online courses. And then there's a revenue model there as well, where we could charge small hosting fee for that kind of course, which would include the local options as well. Or a lot of the local university and high school still offer courses that otherwise would not be available to their students. So those are the cases that are good for the community to be able to have such access. And so what helps to lose value through the problem with the legislation would be very helpful. And I'm really delighted that Minnesota is on the bleeding edge, from the cutting edge of legislation here. And I'm really going to applaud you for being the community.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I had a very different kind of question. It relates to Sparks. Why would a participating university want to have you provide that service? Don't they have the capabilities to do that themselves?
The question is, you can run the Sparks, SBOC, small private and business. Why would one university want to go Sparks and one university? First of all, I point out that while the commanding view of the Sparks are the same university, so for example, the Berkeley Sparks are actually the same university. In addition to the MOOC on Berkeley, you can also realize that course is offered on the Berkeley campus of the Sparks at the same time. So, first of all, campus are using the Sparks integrity to benefit their students as well. But in addition, a number of other campuses want to use these course materials in their own course, which might be respected. I view these thoughts as the next generation textbook. If I can get a good set of exercises, as the world goes on, they don't have that person on the campus. And that's just an example. Now, I don't have a person to be a public on my campus. Why not get the school from somewhere else to offer that on my campus? I have a professor who might be a textbook in my classroom. If I can bring this course on my campus, and if I can move away from the lecture for school, if I'm doing the same lecture semester after semester, what if I can bring this course in and not have to do the lecture? And instead of all the extra time to spend it on longer than the students, why don't I do that? Why don't I get a course in a different university? And you see that. The same encouragement from the University of Iowa State University, they have had amazing success. And the professor in the college of Boston Division, the visit there, and the captain in the study, United States, the United States, is our teaching teacher. But I know he really loves doing this, and he's doing it for them this semester. And he's really doing it.
Course credit. I know there's room. U of M has announced just a few weeks ago that they'll be offering 5 weeks, I believe, of their own. Using Coursera. But how about, what's the movement towards using edX and using Coursera courses for course credit, whether it be in community college or state school or larger
universities?
Revolution around what we
we traditionally think of as higher education and the way we recognize the completion of that.
And that's your question. The question you have to do is, what do you look at in front of you? And it's a great question because, my previous answer was, how can we take this revolution? Because that's the phenomenon of online learning and MOOCs. And how do we choose what we can do with existing degree system? What do we have to do with that? How do we do that? How do we do that? Do you think this is a rethinking of education device? I think that can be a rethinking degree. That can be a certified degree if you take off all sorts of courses in history and you get a history degree. The same thing in my own case can be a science courses. They can take courses in policy. They can take courses in energy. And I'm adding those to it. They also take multidisciplinary courses. And today the only way they can do that is they can do some people's graduate experience. What is the reason you do that? Can I put something called micro-credentials, badges, micro-credentials? Already, the mathematical universities, or degrees or credentials that are working together very closely, and the number of disciplines. So I think that the platforms like that, and online learning, that really define these courses, that allow you to take your own time, your own place, your own geography. I really need to be thinking the concept of a degree, the fact that many of our partners have been thinking about should be teed up and think together for a course. So we have a university of Italy. We offer a great first course in accounting. University of Dean, we offer a great course in our own economics. The University of Surrey, we offer a great course in this topic. We can give you a sequence of courses. We can give you a course and offer a credential. So I'm going to come over here.
There are a lot of opportunities for filling in different ways with this, but do you in all honesty foresee students graduating from high school and sitting in their basement, cobbling together these degrees, or is there still a place for the communal part of college, I guess is what I'm asking?
It's only one part of our university system. And what our system, critically, the non-profit of our system will use, is we have the same with improving access to education for students in smaller economies as in the other places, but at the same time to really make that kind of education. We want to make education much more fun, much better, much more accessible to all our campuses of the country. So looking at the campus of students is not just about courses. It's not a living in life. It's about the experience. It's about the process. Students learn interacting groups from the idea of talking to other students. brainstorm about things. They learn how to discuss and work in groups and collaborate and communicate and learn the record. They learn how to argue and discuss points and pursue. So, you can also hear that in the process of this community. I think you have to be able to use a building. I've been working with them because of the computer program. I've been working with students who have to go to the conference room without all the post-solution. How do you influence others? How do you impact people? How do you change people's lives? How do those things live happen in the classroom? How do they learn this? Last year, I haven't taken a class on the post-solution. I've never taken a class on how to be good, how to change the world. But those skills come from something else. And you work from the underground that you are poor on you. This is the university of different cultures. How do you do that? How do you social services? So all of these things come to some other aspect of the university that you can't get to the finger. And that's why you have a passion. So I think it's really important for students to go to the university. But these are students who are coming? No way. It's going to be a different experience. And then you ask yourself to do about what the machines look like, and one idea that is something they call continuous education. Not continuing education, but continuous education. Just imagine, why is it that you have these 14 students after high school spend 4 years? At this time, thou shalt spend 4 years in this college, and then you could throw me away, and for the next 50 years, you don't work. Why 4? Why not 3 years? Why not 10 years? Why just until you stop for us to play out? Can you guarantee that what you learn in these 4 years is exactly what you're going to need for the rest of the year, 15 years of your life? But no. So you can't predict what you're going to look like 15 years from there. So what do you think that you know exactly what you need to do for a year? So it's an education machine. So what will happen is that one is that it's continuous education. You know, students are going to be doing it, they are taking many courses in the university. Before they come in, they're racing. And so maybe they don't need to do the first year, maybe they get the credit, just like an AP card. So that's when they get credit for the first year course. Now that means 2 years. But that's when they get 2 years to the university. So why keep them for 2 years? Maybe the last year, they go out into work study programs, they go out into industry. And when they go out into take courses online from the same university or other universities, they do that online. So for now, it becomes continuous education. For 4 years, you have work. And you think about this kind of number, and then over the first year and the fourth year, before you can continue to live with lifelong learning, where before, they actually go to college. So this may be the best of your career, you have a college experience, so now you get continuous learning for the rest of your career, but this may be one month. So the building of the teamwork that you have, and so far, 4 year teaching, and so you have the cost of college to do your degree education. But then you say, well, there's a university. But your students are 3 years away, but you're not taking classes in many students. So you want to still have a year of time learning in it. Okay? But then you would argue, still a business student something. I think that my assumption is that in previous college of education, we have many more students applying than we have high college education ability. And so, the number of veterans in that, and I can even tell you that you can't admit that the students are not that kind of class. And so now, we're able to admit veterans. I think technology, there is a way for technology to impact you in front of the way, but for the building of all of them, you don't have to have a user for every day. You can have a win-win in technology.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming out.
No problem. And thank you all. I applaud you and the work that you're doing. You're looking for legislation and the right of these technological changes. And there's a lot of help. And you have been leading edge for a long time. And so if you want to help, that's really good. Thank you.
Thank you so much.